Weather forecasts provide us valuable information on extreme weather, like storms, heat waves, droughts, and floods. Climate forecasts are guiding society and policymakers how to mitigate and adapt to climate change. A major bottleneck to improved forecasts is computational performance. Models with higher resolution and more complexity will produce more accurate predictions, but are also vastly more expensive to calculate. Conventional weather and climate models calculate with 64-bit double precision numbers, while the climate system comes with many uncertainties. The observations are imperfect, the mathematical equations are simplified, and there are discretization errors too. In the presence of large uncertainties, most rounding errors will be masked and not decrease the fidelity of the forecast. The European Weather Forecast Center, ECMWF, now uses Float32, that means single precision, operationally. The resulting 1.7 times speedup are invested into a higher resolution, increasing the forecast skill. But can we go even lower? How many bits do we really need? Modern hardware more and more supports 16-bit formats. GPUs can calculate with Float16, Float16 and the new ARM-based chips A64FX, which are also used in the currently fastest supercomputer Fugaku in Japan, promise 4x speedups with Float16 compared to Float64. While in the past low precision numbers were hardly supported on hardware, the future is likely 16-bit, if not less. Sounds exciting, but more speed also comes with a price. Float16 has a drastically reduced range of representable numbers compared to the good old 32-bit single precision. 10 to the minus 9 is 0, and 10 to the 5 is infinity in this format. So avoiding underflows and overflows suddenly becomes a really big challenge. There is a trade-off between precision and range. While BFloat16, for example, retains the wide range from Float32, it can only represent numbers with less than 3 decimal places of precision, so the precision is even further reduced. And managing these rounding errors is then a challenge too. While changing from 64 to 32-bit might be easily possible, a naive transition to 16-bit is unlikely successful. So, what can we do? Given a set of equations that we want to solve, the ones here are simplified yet similar to those in every climate model, we may ask how to squeeze every single calculation into Float16. And how can we know that numbers will stay in a certain range? Solving partial differential equations isn't easy. The discretization, for example, finite difference or spectral, will have a big influence on the model code and the numbers calculated within. And then there are also stability constraints, incorrectly choosing some parameters, and the whole simulation blows up. But there are manipulations of the equations possible that can help to change the numbers calculated without actually changing the physical problem. Reordering, that means changing the order in which calculations are performed, or rescaling, that means, for example, making something bigger first, which is then undone later. Here we use a multiplicative scaling that basically just multiplies a scalar s to our equations, and then every nonlinear term has to be unscaled, and for output, we also have to unscale. Last year at JuliaCon, I presented a tool, Sherlock.jl, which is a great help for this. An analysis number format that can be used as any other number format in type flexible functions in Julia. After every arithmetic operation, so that means plus, times, minus, divide, it logs the result into a logbook. A bit pattern histogram that helps to understand which numbers occur how often in the code. The purple histogram doesn't fit well into Float 16, and you can see that there is a wide range of the histogram that would be below the Float 16 range. So many numbers would underflow to zero if one were to use Float 16. But the orange version of the code, and this is now where we've changed some of the ordering of the operations, actually does fit into Float 16. Sherlock's.jl also comes with Dr. Watson, a number format that finds problematic lines of the code for you. It will check where a certain condition is met and returns a stack trait if. Here, for example, we want to know where subnormals occur, so we provide a function isSubnormal that returns true in case that's the case, and Dr. Watson then says in a multiplication in line 320 there was a subnormal, and so we can identify this, look into the code, and think about how to reformulate these lines. Using these tricks, we managed to squeeze ShallowWaters.jl into Float 16, using 97% of the available numbers and avoiding subnormals. Subnormals are inefficiently supported on A64FX, so that we want to avoid them first and then flush the remaining ones to zero to maintain full performance. Without scaling, that's the green curve here, 3% of the numbers in ShallowWaters.jl would have been subnormals, causing a drastic slowdown. Addressing the range does not necessarily also address precision issues. Once we realized that many rounding errors originated from the time integration, which is effectively a very large sum of small terms, there are tricks to address precision critical operations too. In our case, implementing a compensated summation into the time integration did the trick, and rounding errors from Float 16 were significantly reduced at minimal additional cost. Then we ported ShallowWaters.jl with Julia 1.6 to A64FX. Yes, there were some small Float 16 related bugs, but everything else just worked out of the box. The reference simulation in Float 64 that you can see here took a few hours on a single core, using Float 16, scaled equations, and a compensated time integration as illustrated earlier. The simulation then was about 4 times faster while yielding remarkably similar results. The remaining rounding errors are absolutely tolerable and would easily be masked by other errors in more realistic climate models. If you've been working on similar problems, please get in touch. I'm always keen to collaborate and to exchange ideas.